Bonjour à toutes et à tous, je suis ravie de vous retrouver pour une nouvelle interview sur epirum.com. Je m'appelle Ihsan et aujourd'hui j'ai le plaisir d'accueillir Victoria Navarro qui va nous parler des soft skills en médecine ou les différentes capacités, les différents domaines de compétences qu'on pourrait avoir et acquérir ou qu'on devrait avoir et acquérir en dehors de la médecine pure et dure. Et aujourd'hui on va parler de l'épidémiologie.
Good morning, Sam. It's for me a pleasure to participate here in this post. I'm Victoria Navarro Compan. I work as a rheumatologist and as a researcher at the University Hospital La Paz and at the Research Foundation of La Paz Hospital in Madrid. And well, I'm very glad to have this conversation with you and to add wherever I'm able for all the audience.
Thank you. My first question will be what soft skills means and epidemiological in particular for you as a doctor.
Well, I would say that when we start thinking about being doctors, we think usually about the non-soft skills. We think about the skills which are very important and necessary to do to be a good clinician. Also, the soft skills are important to be a good clinician. They are complementary. They are very useful to the research. You cannot do research without them. But in addition, they help a lot to improve your clinical practice. So, well, with this, I will say that for me, the soft skills are those that are not the scientific knowledge that you have, but the skills that complement you as a clinician or researcher. For example, we could talk about the epidemiological knowledge, the languages. For example, the English is a very important skill, and also about the communication skills, which are becoming more and more relevant in our society. And these are, for me, I would say, the main soft skills that are helpful to achieve a successful career.
Okay, and why epidemiological topics are important in our daily practice, or how is it important?
I would say how it changed my practice,
your practice, yeah.
or my professional career. Well, I finished medicine. I almost had no experience with research. I had done that very small work under the supervision of a mentor, but not really a research work. So after this, we usually get here the national exam to access the specialty. And directly, I start doing the specialty of rheumatologist and to focus mainly on learning clinical skills, first in internal medicine and then more specific in rheumatology. So of course, I attended the clinical session and there we discussed, for example, some methodological aspects of some manuscripts. I started submitting some small abstracts to national congresses, but that was all I could do. Then I went I went to Berlin to do an internship, and I realized that being a clinician and a doctor, being a doctor was more than just being visiting patients, and that there were other skills that I lacked and that I needed to improve, such as the being able to understand studies, to develop protocols, to do the analysis. For us, I think that when we think about research, we think about inserting data, which is just a minor step of the research. And I would say the one that I enjoy less. But then I realized I didn't have these skills. So I started doing my PhD and I was not really understanding what I was doing. So I decided to take an epidemiological master in science, in epidemiology in Maastricht, at the University of Maastricht in the Netherlands. And I needed to go there because at that moment, I would say the opportunities in Spain to do a master, especially in English, in research, were not so diverse. And in that place, they had experience. And that, I can say that has changed my career. I would say the two main things that have changed my career, the three is one, being able to speak in English, not to be good at English, but at least to speak and communicate in English. Second, going abroad to contact other people. And third, to do this master and to continue learning in epidemiology. Why? Because now I'm able first to design my own studies with a group of colleagues and collaborators to do the analysis. It's very important that we do not go to a statistics a statistician to do the analysis, because when you the statistician usually have the knowledge of only the statistical part, but lack of the rheumatologist knowledge. While if you have both, you are able to extract much more from the same data than when you have only one of them. Yeah. It is very important that we understand what we do, that we do ourselves the analysis, or that at least we understand which are the limitations, and then that we are able to report the results in a consistent and trustful way. Mm-hmm. It's very important that we do not just report things without being sure that this is what is happening in the data. And that was more in the for the research, but for the clinical aspect, I would say that it helps you to be critical. Mm-hmm. It helps you to be critical with all the studies that pharma comes and brings, and then you are able to realize whether or not it is good evidence or not. And also you can apply this for your patients. I mean, let's say that usually I don't buy most of the things that come to my hands, and you find the limitations of the studies. And in addition to this, I would say that you are, if you have also the epidemiological knowledge, you are able to provide many more ideas for your hospital, for other colleagues, for groups, for pharma industry, because you have another point of view. And I would say that in total, it complements very well the clinical part.
So with the knowledge of epidemiological field, if I could resume, could be more accuracy in our profession, and we could make and do a better job with our patients, with the good information and with the critical of the paper, and it's help us to choose the good drugs under the scope of the epidemiological principle.
Yes, are you that's agree? Totally correct.
Okay. In your country, in Spain, how this field is organized? Is there any master or any university diploma or?
I would say I can compare two countries mainly who are quite different. One is in Spain, the other one is the Netherlands. I will tell you, well, here in Spain, we finished the career in which I don't think that we learn much more about epidemiological. I mean, we need to study, we need to learn what is a p-value, but I don't think that we really understand what's a p-value. Or I think we learn from a theoretical point of view, but we never apply that knowledge. If you never apply, if you don't do the analysis yourself, this is, you will forget it. This is like a studying diseases. We realized that this is much easier when we arrive to clinical practice and we start visiting patients. That's when your head retains this information. And in Spain, I would say that probably at least 80, 90% of the doctors, at least rheumatologists, mainly practice in clinical practice. They do not work in research. There are many reasons behind this. I would say first, because we don't have the enough educational programs to do this, but also because we do not spend enough time on educating on epidemiological skills, and also because research is usually not funded. If you get a salary for visiting patients, but not for doing research, in the end, you want to visit patients. This is the case in Spain. Then we have the opposite case, which is in the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, I was quite surprised because usually students finish their career and then they get a job to do their PhD in a department. That doesn't need to be the department in which you will do the specialty. And it is common that you change the specialty after this. Why? Because during those 3 or 4 years that they do their PhD full time, they just work on learning and doing research. So they don't focus on the topic itself. They focus on method, on methods, which will be with them for the rest of the life. Why do they do this? Well, because I think they think it's important, but also because then to get job as specialist, you get a better position if you have done a PhD, even if you don't want to do research in the future, than if you have not done it. Why? Because they assume that you will be much better clinician if you have this background.
Okay. What could be your advice, your tip and tricks for the young doctor or the young student that wants to learn more on epidemiological fields and how to do epidemiology?
Well, I would say that for young people, I will not say for those who want, I will say that this is almost mandatory for everyone who will want to be a scientist in the future. I mean, I'm, let's say, in the average generation. I'm not the generation that cannot understand social media, but I'm not the generation who started who was born with the social media. But for this generation, I will say that we are really getting into a world of data, big data. There is only one way that we will be able to understand this data, which is if we have the knowledge to analyze and to understand the data. The tips is that if possible, if you have someone who with some experience around, look for him, look for her. You can look mainly, I would say, some for the research is usually measured many in publications. You can look for people, teams of research teams and groups. And I will look for someone around to start, to see if I like, to see what I can do. And I start with a small projects, easy projects. And then once you have tested this and see if you like, if you really want to go that way, if you want to get deeper into the knowledge of epidemiology, I will follow one educational program. Now, I think there are many opportunities because there are several online programs. Also, if you go abroad or if you go to another city, I think that's a great opportunity. But I will not do it on top of all the clinical duties. Why? Because then you will not focus on this only. I will do it the same time that you will invest in being a clinician.
Yeah.
You should also invest in having other soft skills.
Thank you a lot for your advice to keep someone around with experience in epidemiology to see if you like or not, and after go to do the education to progress in the soft skill like epidemiological tips and social communication. Thank you, Victoria, for your time. I was really happy to have you for this talk and hope that you have you again for another topic on epidemiology.
Well, thank you. It has been a pleasure for me. Thank you very much.